Hey, this is Valerie Love. I want to share with you or talk with you a little bit about your soul's calling, your soul's mission, why you're here on the planet. And I figured I'd share with you a story from my own journey and prayerfully that it will support you in living your purpose and your destiny and doing it today, that you don't have a moment to waste, that you're here on a mission. You may remember the mission, you may not fully remember the mission, but you're here on a mission. Your soul came here for a purpose. My soul came here to be a catalyst for transformation through the spoken and written word. So my goal, my mission, my purpose, my calling, my passion, and my love is to be a catalyst for transformation, to get people or ourselves to think differently, to do something differently, and therefore for the soul to evolve back to where we all came from, and that's the one, God. In this walk from New York, in this walk that I had in my soul, this soul walk in this particular incarnation, I was born in Harlem in New York City, and I went to Washington Irving High School. When I got to Washington Irving High School, now the story actually starts long before that, of course, as all stories do. I'll give you a little snippet from when I was in elementary school. When I was in elementary school, they had these tests that they would give us, these reading tests and writing tests and things like that. And they always told my mom, she scores so high on her test. She's on an eighth grade reading level. And I was like second grade, third grade. It was like 12th grade reading level. Oh, she's just amazing. We want to skip her. And my mom said, no, don't skip her to the next grade. She might miss something. No. And so I stayed right where I was. But at any rate, this whole reading thing, when I was a kid, when I was about 5 or 6 years old, I would rather read a book than go outside and play. Now, my brother, completely the opposite. He didn't want to see a book. He wanted to go outside and play, and he stayed outside and played as long as he possibly could. If you wanted to find me when I was a kid, you saw me with my head stuck between the pages of a book, fascinated by books, fascinated by books. And I remember having a dream when I was little. If one day I could grow up and write a book, I would be so happy. That was my dream when I was little. So I'm always reading books, reading books, reading books, love reading, go to the library and read the kid books. I would devour them, and books took me to this far off place. And what I didn't really fully know, understand on all levels is that this was pointing my heart's passion and desire, my love was pointing me. It was to the North Star, as Julia Orloff talks about the North Star. It was pointing me in the direction of my soul. I didn't know that at that time on all levels. I knew it on some level, not on all levels. So I went to high school. When I got to high school, I was in ninth grade. I'll never forget. I was in ninth grade, Washington Irving High School in New York City, in the village in New York City. It's still there. And at that time, it was an all-girls school, and I was in ninth grade. And Miss Freeman was the head of the English department. And Miss Freeman, I knew Miss Freeman. She was the chair of the English department. So one day Miss Freeman called for me. This was maybe around April of my ninth year. So a couple of more months and we were going to be finished with ninth grade. It was my first year in high school. And Miss Freeman called for me. And I got nervous. Miss Freeman, why does Miss Freeman want to see me? She called me to come to her office. Why does Miss Freeman want to see me? I did all my homework. I went into the meltdown. I didn't think it could be something good. I was thinking, oh no, what did I do wrong? I didn't get something right. What went wrong? So anyway, aside from all my fear and trepidation, I went to Miss Freeman's office, and I'm sitting there in Miss Freeman's office, and she wasn't there, so that just gave me more time to be in a meltdown about fear and whatnot, look all around and be scared. So finally, Miss Freeman walked in, and she sat down, and she looked at me, and she said, you are an excellent writer. And I said, huh? I kind of had this deer in the headlights look like, huh? And she said, I remember this conversation like it was yesterday. This conversation was like 30-some years ago. She said, you are an excellent writer. She said, and the reason I wanted to talk to you, because I've been reading all your papers that you've been writing. And I thought, she's been reading all my papers that I've been writing in high school? I thought only my high school teacher was reading my papers. Miss Freeman had been reading my papers. She said, I want to invite you to program. And this program is called English A, English Honors. And in the program, it's a 10th, 11th, and 12th grade program. She said, and you'll be in this program with me, and I will personally teach you and develop you into the writer that you are. She said, and we're going to study all of the amazing works of the most amazing writers that have ever walked this planet. We'll study Chaucer, and we'll study Poe, and we'll study Shakespeare, and we'll study all of the greats at that time, the greats. And we're going to dissect them, and you'll learn how to hone that gift and master that gift. She said, now this is a commitment. Are you committed? Because I only take 10 students from the 10th grade, 10 students from the 11th grade, and 10 students from the 12th grade, the top 10, and I spend the next 3 years with them. We start in September. Are you committed? Because if you're committed, you're invited. If you're not committed, forget we had this conversation. She made it very clear that I had to commit to 3 years of excellence in my studies of English, of language arts, of the masters of the written word, and that I myself would hone myself into being a master of the written word. I had to promise. I had to make a commitment. And I'm like, yeah. Now, what she didn't realize was that besides the fear of committing, because the fear of committing did come up, greater than the fear of commitment was the opportunity and the heart song that was bursting from me when she talked about what we were going to read, that we were going to read Chaucer and Edgar Allan Poe and Shakespeare and all of the greats of Wordsworth and all of these incredible authors and writers and people that I considered to be, it was like she was singing my heart song. And I said, after all these years, someone gets me. It was this big, full heart yes to what she was saying. So that kind of swept the fear of the commitment out. I was like, yeah, commit. Yeah, yes, I'm in. And for the next 3 years, I went on a ride with Miss Freeman, and we went all over the universe in books. We went all over the universe in books. And then she got me to write for the school newspaper. And then she got me to write for the school journal, the sketchbook that came out every year. And she got me to do some journalism. And I loved it. And I loved the writing. Now here's where the tricky part comes in. I tell my parents, oh, I'm loving this. I'm loving this. I'm loving my writing. I'm loving this writing. I'm loving what we're reading. I'm in the books all the time. And my mom and dad, very conservative, said, how do you make money? How do you support yourself writing? They didn't know how that happened. And my parents were Jehovah's Witnesses, and they did not believe at that time in going to college. And of course, Ms. Freeman, all she was talking about was you're going to go to college. Of course, you're going to go to colleges. You're going to continue your writing. You're going to be one of the best journalists ever. You're going to write. You're going to be an amazing writer. That's, yeah, she saw it so clearly. And I was in this two-way world, Ms. Freeman and the love and school and writing and all of this. And my parents, like, you're a Jehovah's Witness. You're not going to college. You're going to get a trade and a skill that will teach you how to make money and sustain yourself. And you're going to be a Jehovah's Witness and go to the Kingdom Home. That's all we want to hear from you. So that was the world I was living in, and my heart's passion and my heart's calling and what I had, what I was told I had to do. That was the two choices. That you ever come to those forks in the road in your life where you could go either way and you know you're at a pivotal fork in the road. I was at a pivotal fork in the road. So I spent my 3 years with Ms. Freeman, and because I was more a good girl, I did what my parents told me to do. So when I graduated, so in addition to hanging out with Miss Freeman and doing all this wonderful Edgar Allan Poe and Shakespeare, oh, they let me have all that. They said, oh, read all the books you want in high school. And we also want you to take shorthand and typing, because when you get out, you'll be a secretary. And that, we know, you can earn money with that. You can make good money with that, working in the offices downtown in New York City, and you can climb right up the ladders and right up the ranks, and you'll be doing good, and you'll support yourself, and life will be good. So my parents made me take the secretarial studies classes. So I had Miss Noonan, and I was learning how to do shorthand, and I was learning how to type and all this. And I had to fix my mind on being a secretary, working in an office. What I really wanted to do was be on that typewriter, writing books and writing for newspapers and all that kind of stuff, journalist and everything. So I did both. I did what my parents told me to do, and I had the experience with Ms. Freeman. It was a rich, rich, beautiful experience through my whole high school years. Well, when I left high school, I pretty much left the writing right there where it was, but the writing never died. It never died. It was still there. So I left the writing, and I went off, and I did the secretarial studies that they told me to do, and I worked in offices, and I kept working in offices, and I continued going through my life. The writing always gnawed at me. It was like a gnawing from the inside that, you know, there's something you're here to do. And it was this insistent, you know, you're here to write. And to tell you the truth, all the things worked together perfectly because my mom and dad told me that I had to do this whole typing thing and the shorthand thing, which I still use the shorthand to this day. So it was all perfect, and I learned to type, and that was perfect because I type every day. And now, where I am now, after decades going maybe on a roundabout journey, it was still all the journey of the soul. It was still all necessary. It was still all, it is all perfect to bring me to this right now place where I'm now the author, published author of 3 books, working on book 4, 5, and 6, love writing. I blog every day. I've been blogging for years at Live Your Destiny Today. I love it. I write every day of my life. I write ebooks. I write blog posts. I write articles. I write books. I write. Till the cows come home, and I love it. I love it. So what I came to share with you today is it doesn't matter how roundabout it looks like your journey is. Your journey is roundabout for a reason. You're going in these different directions for a reason. You're still always on the soul's journey. You never got off the soul's journey. I may think that somewhere along the way, I was off the soul's journey when I was off doing something other than writing, when I was working in an office and typing. I wasn't. I was still on the journey of the soul. You're still always on the journey of your soul, even when it looks like you're not. The encouragement that I want to give you, the insight that I pray to share with you, is that stay on purpose. The best that you can do in each moment to live your purpose, do it. The best that you can do in each moment to make choices for things that make you happy and make your heart song sing, do those things. And little by little, step by step, curve by precious curve, you'll land right where you are to be. I promise you, you will land right where you are to be, and you will be in bliss, living spot on, right on your purpose. I call it the sweet spot. The sweet spot is where your power, your passion, your purpose, and your prosperity all align. The first time somebody gave me money to write, I almost thought I was going to fall off my chair when my first agent called me and told me that I had a book deal and they were going to pay me 5 figures to write 2 books, a 2-book deal. They not only wanted the book that I was offering them, they wanted me to write another book for them too, and they're going to pay me money. How much? What? You talk about heaven. You talk about going to heaven, as Alex Mandozian said, going to heaven without the inconvenience of dying. That was me. I was in bliss. And every time I do what I love, every time I'm on the soul's journey and I'm doing what I love of effecting transformation in consciousness through the written word, through the spoken word, it gives me joy. There's this deep fulfillment that comes up in me from it. And it is bliss. It's bliss. I call it soulgasm. I'm writing a book about it. It'll be out soon. Soulgasm. Soulgasm is where you want to be. Soulgasm is the alignment of all that you're to be and all that you're to do and all that you're to have. That's soulgasm. All of it aligned with the best and the best of who you are. I love you. I'm so happy I got to share this message with you today. And I assure you that I'm here to support you as a divine midwife. I'm here to support you in birthing your gifts, your purpose into the world. If there's anything that I can do to support you in your soul's journey, get in touch with me. Online at liveyourdestinytoday.com. My email is there. My phone number is there. Call me. I'm open. Have a beautiful and blessed day. I love you. And know that you are to take action today. What's my tagline? I said at the end of my videos. Oh, yeah, I remember it now. Visit me online at liveyourdestinytoday.com. Today, not tomorrow. Procrastination is a terminal illness. I love you. Be blessed.